know that you usually do a nice small version with your groups every morning as you look at your challenge problems. Today you're going to do the full form version of a math circle. A math circle is a group of scholars. Typically, I separate my class into groups of four. The scholars will then work together to, first of all, determine what is the question even asking. So they are given a question prompt, and as you can probably see, I have a special set of papers that I use for them that I staple together so that they have plenty of room to complete each step. They're given the prompt, they glue it onto the front, they discuss and annotate the prompt. They have to determine their own language objective for the lesson. They don't know what the math objective is yet because they're not sure which skill they're going to use. That's part of the process that they're trying to determine. So they have a language goal of how they can discuss it and what they'll use. What can we guess? What's another question? Destiny.
What do we know?
What do we know? After they've annotated the problem together, they come up with the list of assumptions. So what do they know? What don't they know yet? And what could they guess if they looked at the context clues within the question?
The numbers we know are 1/3 divided by 2/1, and we know it's division because each pillar uses an amount of concrete, so we gotta see, they're distributing the concrete on each pillar.
The scholars will receive points for this particular activity because group work is very important. It's important that they can communicate with their peers. It's important that they can present to me and have a cogent argument as to why their answer is either valid or invalid. So that will be point assessed.
We can guess that it's probably going to be multiplication if it's tons.
Sometimes we need to multiply or divide.
Yeah. So we need to find like keywords in the prompt. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and then underline them.
Okay, then you show articulation.
After they've come up with that list of facts, then they have their SLED, which is sketch, label, estimate, and discuss. So that's basically sort of a catch-all space for them where it's just get your thought process out. If you were comparing it to language arts, it would be organizing your thoughts or filling in a graphic organizer. I give them materials that they are able to select from based on what they think they need. If the materials that I give them are insufficient, they're welcome to ask me, hey, we also need a protractor or a ruler or whatever else it is they think.
When you multiply 1/3 to a number, it could be like one of those answers. So
yeah,
it's a great idea.
So instead of 1/2, we could cut right here and then make the change.
Excellent estimation.
After SLED, they head into calculate. Calculate is the area where they are expected to solve the problem in usually more than one way. Most of the problems that I give them will have more than one solution or more than one way to find a solution. My role as a teacher during math circles is largely one of facilitation. By the time I get to a math circle, I have at that point already taught the math skills that lead up to it. So there are days where it's, you know, the sort of traditional my turn, our turn lecture style of math implementation where they're learning new skills and concepts. But as a culminating activity every 1 to 2 weeks, once that set of skills is firmly established, that's when I give them the math circles. And really that's when I need to step back. The math circles are actually about them figuring out on their own if something is valid or not, and why, if it's invalid, they've reached that conclusion. And beyond that, even being able to defend and justify why something is valid or invalid. So I walk around class, I make sure that everybody's on topic, everybody is speaking in academic vocabulary. I often just offer praise when I see something happening that's good, and give them sort of positive feedback so that they're willing to continue to try, because that's something that our scholars really need to learn, is to persevere, to solve the difficult problems and to not give up. And if you get it wrong, that's fine, but why? Why was it wrong? Don't just accept, oh well, I got it wrong.
Wait, you're cut off?
Mm-hmm.
All right, we convert the fraction, then the number. The whole number.
Once they have calculated, again, as a group, they need to be working with all four team members, they write their articulation. I give them the option of writing the articulation independently or as a group, because they did solve it as a group, so their articulation should be fairly similar. If they've worked together, then they all follow the same steps. They should be writing those steps down. But if they just prefer to work independently at that time and sort of gather their thoughts and organize them on the paper, that's fine by me too. During math circles, when my scholars are off task, it does occasionally happen. I have the same mix-up of a group as everybody else. It's fairly easy for their teammates first to redirect them. So I rely initially on teammates to redirect. So teammates are sort of the first line of defense. And if I notice that, or if another scholar reports to me that there's an issue at a table, then I'll come over, and I think redirecting has really worked very well. Also, I found proximity works quite well. If somebody's being goofy in their group, they will not be goofy when you're standing right next to them. I heard a lot of really great conversations happening. I noticed that my scholars were all on task, and even the kids who were taking the wrong path to solve the problem were using the proper vocabulary. They had the skills, they just chose the wrong one.
When we check for validity, we drew a picture and still got 2/3 as our product. Finally, we simplified. 2/3 is our...
After they've completed solving the entire problem, then they do the presentation portion, which is almost always on a second or third day, because math circles are not a quick process. They take quite a long time.
Sled, sketch, label, estimate, and discuss. We put 1/3 because it says 1/3 to 1/3 of concrete to support a pillar. The problem will be 1/3 divided by 2/2, 2 holes, because it is division.
The idea of the presentation is that when you teach, you learn even stronger, and the presenter needs to be learning this material very solidly by sharing it with the rest of the class, but the rest of the class also needs to be absorbing and understanding what they're trying to say.
The shaded part is the numerator of the concrete the engineer used for the pillars. Here we cut out a circle. We shaded the part to figure out what the shaded part is. The shaded part is the numerator.
Math circles will help with the Common Core implementation, because often during Common Core and with the new tests, they're given a problem, not given any indication of what they need to do to solve it. They are asked to come up with their own solution based on the knowledge they already have. And math circles are sort of a lower stress version of that, because they have these other resources of teammates who they can say, hey, I'm thinking about multiplying here, or I'm thinking about dividing. And another teammate might say, well, I was going to divide until I noticed that such and such was happening. And again, it's just sort of a lower stress way for them to work that thought process out until it becomes second nature. And hopefully with enough practice, they'll be able to internalize that and do it independently, so that when they're working on their own papers at home or at school, or they're taking a test, they have those skills already, and that set of ideas of what they need to do to proceed is established. All right, so what I have in my mind is this construction engineer who has to make 2 pillars. So here's pillar number 1 that he has to make. And here's pillar number 2 that he has to make. Doesn't need to be perfect. A sketch is exactly that. It's just a quick sketch. So here are the pillars that he has to make. How much concrete does he order to make those 2 pillars? 1/3 of a ton. So he orders 1/3 of a ton of concrete. That 1/3 of a ton of concrete has to go to each pillar. The pillars are the same size, so they each get half. They each get half.